Whoa! What is this? Bug. Windows 11. When we first covered the insider back in July 2021, there were a couple of bugs, and things were not final. But now it's actually out, it's matured, the bugs have been squashed. But these are your bugs that you try and squash and it's like they've got titanium shell armor. They stick around. Though, I've been using Windows 11 for about 13 months now on my main computer, and I think it's time to finally share every change since Windows 10 and my thoughts on if it's worth upgrading to, especially if you're a current Windows 10 user and you've been on the fence. Now, with Windows 10 versus 11, the keys will work interchangeably, so if you wanted to try out Windows 11 for yourself, you can always go back to Windows 10 with the same key. And remember, on personal machines, you always want a single end user license key, or if you have a pre-built or a laptop, an OEM key, but not volume keys. And the best place to get cheap, single end user Windows license keys is with today's video sponsor, SCD Keys. Never pay full price for Windows 10 or Windows 11 keys again, especially since we started a promotional offer for Black Friday of 2020. That was 2 years ago, but it's been so popular with this community, it's been active ever since. So if you use the coupon code BFTYC with the link in the description below, you'll still get 30% off. That brings the current price for these keys down to only $14.50. And if you aren't sure if these are legit, we did a whole video about what to look out for from resellers. And we even called Microsoft directly, and they said these are absolutely fine. Okay, I've taken up enough of your time. Let's get into this huge video. So we'll start from the basics, the requirements for an upgrade. And this was controversial because initially Microsoft said they weren't allowing CPUs older than Intel 8th Gen, that's 8000 series CPUs like the i7-8700K for example, and Ryzen 3000 for AMD, for instance the Ryzen 5 3600. But now they've removed those requirements altogether from their requirements website, and I even did a fresh install on a 6th Gen Intel PC just the other day without any hiccups. But the other controversial requirement is TPM 2.0 and Secure Boot. If you're happy to do a fresh install instead of an upgrade, you can always use Rufus to etch out a Windows 11 ISO onto a USB to bypass this altogether. So again, no biggie. Though a big question from the last video was, do I need to upgrade my boot drive? Is Windows 11 going to be bigger? And the answer is yes and no. Windows 10 required 20 gigabytes to install from your hard drive or your SSD, and Windows 11 requires a 64 gigabyte drive. But with updates, Windows 10 takes up a lot more space and Windows updates are smaller on Windows 11. My Windows 11 install currently takes up 35 gigabytes, for example, with all the latest updates, drivers, and everything. So even if you've got the smallest 128 gigabyte boot drive, you're probably going to be fine. You also need 4 gigabytes of RAM compared to the 2 gigabyte requirement from Windows 10. But it should be noted that Windows 11 uses less RAM, even though the requirements are higher. Guess they just wanted a better minimum experience. You also need a 720p monitor, but these are basically a given in 2022. Windows also requires a 64-bit processor, but seeing as X64 came out in 1999, and CPUs with X64 support were mainstream by 2005, I think you'll be fine there too. And even 32-bit or legacy programs will continue to work. Though, quickly touching on security. Windows 10 has official support until 2025. Microsoft hasn't said if they're going to continue security patches past then, but if your situation needs the best security, you should always keep your device up to date, whether it's Windows 10 or 11. But if you do have a newer computer that has TPM, then it is going to be much more resilient to a lot of these new attacks that are coming out. Though onto gaming, and I know a lot of my viewers are gamers, that's why I benchmark games for every hardware release. Though, is your FPS going to be higher on Windows 11 versus 10? And the short answer is actually yes, but not by a lot, only around a few percent. I did a video a year ago and it's only become more optimized since. But why, you may ask? Well, Windows 11 has better hardware scheduling, so the processes are happening slightly more efficiently behind the scenes. One of the big performance boosts on Windows 11 is the native support and optimization for chiplet and hybrid architectures from AMD and Intel, respectively. So those P and E cores will work and schedule much better than Windows 10. But also there's some new tech coming out like direct storage and resizable bar. For instance, an AMD CPU coupled with an AMD GPU will take advantage of this technology called Smart Access Memory, which works both on Windows 10 but really takes advantage of these better optimizations on Windows 11. The Windows 11 also has better memory management, which combines with the new game mode, which detects when you're in a game and limits unnecessary background tasks. But don't worry, Discord, Spotify, and any app that you are thinking of will certainly still work flawlessly. But it's not just about the performance when it comes to gaming. There's also a bunch of quality of life improvements from their new stance on gaming. They're bringing features from the Xbox Series X like Auto HDR for games that don't support HDR, but run modern engines like GTA 5 and Rainbow Six Siege. And Auto HDR works amazingly. You get no clipping, the mapping is seamless, and in my experience, it's never got the HDR wrong where you notice a flaw. As opposed to Windows 10, I don't know if you guys remember trying to turn on HDR. If you turned it on, it just made the desktop look like complete ass. Though also a lot of that has been fixed on Windows 10 too. I just feel like HDR works a lot better on Windows 11. Though one of the most important fixes, especially for my competitive bros out there, is the apparent lower latency due to more optimized scheduling. But we're talking about a few microseconds here. It's not something you will notice, though another improvement is because of the way Windows 11 rendering works, its variable refresh rate technology, as well as G-Sync, works in borderless natively and Windows modes compared to Windows 10, where borderless was quite buggy. NVIDIA supports Windows 7 with RTX 3000, but only Windows 10 and 11 for RTX 4000. So it's only a matter of time before you will eventually need to jump ship to continue getting the latest optimizations, even from your GPU manufacturer. Though let's get back to the topic of quality of life upgrades. You'll get better voice support, and even though Microsoft said it'll get easier for third-party voice assistants working with Windows last year, I still haven't seen anything like Google Assistant, Alexa, or alternative support natively in Windows itself. Not that I think you need it, even Microsoft is toning back their insistence on Cortana, which is saying something. HDR also functions much better, with Game Bar supporting HDR screenshots and screen recording, as well as OBS if you want that. But there also isn't a single app that doesn't play nice when HDR is enabled, and as we alluded to before, there's no apps which appear washed out in Windows 11, which is really good to see. Windows 11 is also focusing on their new tablet experience, which is better or worse depending on who you ask. For me, it's cleaner and it still has all the same functionality, as well as better touch and pen support, including haptic feedback. Though onto optimized downloads, you can download Windows updates and Xbox games through other PCs either on your home network or on the internet. And these peer-to-peer downloads are much faster than the Microsoft servers. I have a friend downloading a game on Xbox Game Pass at 600 kilobits. But when turning this feature on, it went to 12 megabits a second, which is his internet limit, unfortunately, but that's a 20-fold increase in download speeds, which isn't available on Windows 10. There's also a better phone link app, which lets you receive notifications from your phone on your desktop and even take calls from your desktop over Bluetooth, which is pretty crazy. Though one aspect of the quality of life updates, as we'd call it, that has gotten worse is the necessity for a Microsoft account to set up your PC. It used to be Home Edition only, where Pro was exempt, but now every edition needs a login, unless you accidentally unplug the Ethernet cable right before you get to that screen, and then accidentally click next while not connected to the internet. But who would never try and evade Microsoft's telemetry gathering monopoly? I mean, would you? And of course, if you upgrade from Windows 10, you won't need one either. Oh, and onto virtual desktops. Microsoft said they've gotten an overhaul, but from what I see, it's just a rename on the Windows 10 feature already, and you can change the wallpapers individually. I mean, it's good if you want to manually separate your work and personal windows, but there's no smart splitting certain apps to specific desktops like Mail or Teams on a work desktop, and there's no stopping you from switching to your personal desktop during work or school hours, or reminders that you're on the wrong desktop and you're probably getting distracted. And I'd like to see the option to really defer you from getting distracted would be to have to force you to put in your password, and this would bring you back to your work desktop every 5 minutes, or something thoughtful like that. Right now, it's a bit of a gimmick. But speaking of gimmicks, and more specifically, as we hinted in the intro, bugs. First, when I open up MP3s on Windows 11, it can just hang for a while. It's a really weird experience. This never happened on Windows 10. And also, what's with Microsoft resizing my icons on a desktop every few months? I'm very happy with my size, Microsoft, especially my icon sizes. There's no need to resize those, and also the search bar. That sometimes comes and goes between updates, and just recently it changed its size automatically and made it smaller. I prefer the default native search bar size. Then within search, I use certain apps a lot, but Microsoft has the infinite wisdom of prioritizing search results by default when I never use those search results from that bar to search the web. I use a browser for that. So why make it the number one thing and put the app that I'm searching for to quickly open right down the bottom of the list? Then there's widgets. If you want a one-stop MSN-powered shop on your news and updates, then I guess it's okay. But for me, it's the first thing I disable on a fresh Windows 11 install. Multitasking, snaps. You still have your snap left or right to make the windows fill up half the screen, and you can still do corners to do a quarter. But now you can hover over the maximize button and choose from three different layouts, including a three-window split, both evenly and with center priority to make whatever you're working on bigger. This feels amazing on ultra-wides, surprisingly, and I think it was made for ultra-wide monitor users or super ultra-wide users in mind. You can also do corners on a three-window split to get five windows all in a neat grid. You can also have multiple tabs in Windows Explorer, and if you've got heaps of folders open, it might help you out. And one of the bugs that annoyed me here, though, and made me want to switch back to Windows 10 initially, was the inability to drag and hover files over apps on the taskbar and or have that app open up afterwards and then use that file in the app all without letting go of the mouse or using the keyboard. And that's now been fixed. I mean, thank you, Microsoft, for fixing something in Windows 11 that was never broken in Windows 10. So the thought behind that one was very weird to begin with. Anyhow, you can enable dark mode for your entire system now using an option in the personalized menu. But it would have been really nice to see this have an auto switch from light mode to dark mode when it reaches a certain time of the night, just like nightlight currently works within Windows itself. So it's light during the day to have maximum visual contrast in the sunlight and dark mode during the night, so you're not getting flashbanged when you open up File Explorer. And finally, the taskbar. Start and icons in the middle. You can choose left or center. I prefer the old school left, though the choice is what is most important here. And well, folks, that's all for today. If you want to know more about a few of these features, we did a video where we highlighted all the features in Windows 11 Insider Edition, and because that list was smaller, we did go into more detail. So check that video out if you want. I'll put the link up here or also in the description below. And if you are still here after all that, you get an e-cookie. Though seriously, if you enjoy the content and you want to see it the moment it drops, then be sure to hit that sub button and ring that bell. And also, links below for that Windows 10 Pro key for $14.50. Remember, you can get the Windows 10 Pro key, save some money, and use it for a Windows 11 install as well. So I'm kind of not sure why you'd bother buying the Windows 11 key. They're basically the same thing. But just make sure you use that code BFTYC on checkout. I'll put the link in the description below for that too. And that's about it for today. If you have any questions or comments about Windows 10, Windows 11, drop a comment. As always, love reading those thoughts and opinions, and I'll catch you in the next one. Peace out for now. Bye.